Hi, everyone. Welcome to Framework Leadership, a podcast about principles and ideas that you can use today to take your leadership to the next level. We're now exclusively a part of the SCU Podcast Network. I'm your host, Kent Engel, president of Southeastern University.
And I'm your co-host, Michael Steiner, SCU Chief of Staff.
And we're excited today to introduce our guests for the show, Don Bramer. Don serves as the chairman of Bramer Group, a company that assists clients in framing and presenting their issues and concerns to Congress and federal agencies. Don is a former intelligence officer, served as an appointee under the administration of President George H.W. Bush. He's a veteran of both combat and Capitol Hill, having served the offices and campaigns of U.S. Senator Mitch McConnell at both state and national levels. So good to have you with us.
Hey, thank you very much, and glad to spend part of my afternoon with you today.
Well, thank you. Now, the Bramer Group is a firm that utilizes relationships fostered within Congress and the executive branch to assist U.S. and foreign companies, organizations, and governments. What motivated you to establish the firm and your passion in this?
You know, one of the things that when I brought together the team that became the foundation or the DNA of Bramer Group is the original three founders were all combat veterans. And we, having all served abroad, had seen what a lot of our men and women in uniform weren't getting when they were downrange, where there were lapses in training, lapses in funding, and lapses in equipment. And then coming from Kentucky and working on the campaigns, I had experienced firsthand what it was like for factories and companies to leave the states to move abroad, and for people to lose their jobs and the effects it had on their families. So I took the two lessons that I learned from working campaigns and being in the military, and figured out that one of the things that I wanted to do was to bring jobs back to the United States, but also at the same time make sure that our men and women never had a opportunity to be in a fair fight, but have everything they needed to win the fight.
Right. Oh, that's so good.
Yeah. And so talk to us a little bit about what were some of these issues specifically. You know, you talk about men and women being downrange, they're in this combat situation. What were some of those first issues where you said, hey, we need some extra help here?
You know, one of the first things is broken equipment, or, you know, for folks who were in the early days of the Iraq War, you know, you'll see a lot of pictures of them in the turret actually manning, you know, a 50 cal or a 230 Gulp, where they were fully exposed, and you know, in a lot of times they became the first fodder for a sniper. And also having that exposed, that open space from a Humvee to the open air, when there would be an IED or a V-bit, that, you know, they would be suffered a traumatic brain injury just because of the blast itself. So our very first effort that we started working on was what they call today CROWS, the Common Remote Operating Weapon System, which actually was a remote turret that replaced the 50 cal and the 230 Gulp, sealed up the Humvee or vehicle so that the entire crew could be safe if there's a blast, but also not exposed to sniper fire.
Yeah.
Love it. And so what did it take to get that kind of action across the board? What does it take to get the government to change, to recognize and see a problem? Walk us through some of the processes you guys used to make.
One of the things that you'll see early on is what they call an UNS. And an UNS is what the military calls an urgent need statement. And that's when you get a general to do a request to Congress that here's a need, and we need to fix this need as fast as possible. We had the client that we were working with, that we're still working with today, that supplied that system. They had it; it was a test case back then, and now we're looking at more than 20,000 systems later abroad in every branch of the military, as well as other agencies, and also many of our allies.
Talk to me a little bit. Does Congress have to authorize all of that, or can some of that action actually be a presidential edict or order, or the Joint Chiefs can authorize? I mean, how does that? Is it always Congress that authorizes?
So, if in the case of an ONS, if there is funds available, what they call unfunded priorities, then it can, if it's a short term. But once it becomes a program or record, then it has to be funds that are authorized by Congress. So it would get a program started, but not necessarily wouldn't keep it. It has to become, you know, tested, certified, and then would have to be requested in the following year of the president's budget, or then put in the what they call the NDA, which is the National Defense Authorization Act, and then funded through appropriations.
Yeah. When you look at what you set to work out, what would you advise leaders who want to get changes across the finish line based on your experience? What's some good approaches to make those kinds of things happen?
I think the most important thing you can do with any legislative initiative is to build your network, to have as many stakeholders as you can.
Yeah.
You know, there is power in numbers. And in one of the cases, and I'll use you a really good example, the manufacturer who does one of our weapon systems that we represent, we've now helped them to establish a supply chain that touches 23 states, 26 congressional districts. So every one of those weapon systems touches 3,200 U.S. jobs.
Wow.
You multiply that, the average family is about four people across U.S. So there, take that number. There's, you know, 3,200 times four. That's a lot of votes. It's a lot of voices. And once or twice a year in a non-COVID scenario, we'll invite representatives not from just our client, but also their supplier base to Washington and let them advocate themselves, give them the story, give them the pitch. We actually will kind of give them a day of coaching. Yeah. And then we turn them loose on the Hill and let them actually go out, meet with their members, explain why this program is important. Not only is it important for our men and women who serve abroad so that they have the best equipment, but it's important for their community and, you know, and the jobs that it creates. And even when you look at the first degree of supplier base to the second degree all the way down, you know, those, the number of jobs and the number of families that each one of those systems touches is immense. And that's what it takes, letting them know that this is important for not just, you know, the Pentagon, but it's important at home too.
Right. Yeah. Now, you've worked at the state and national levels of several key presidential and congressional campaigns. You've continued to actively be engaged in the political process. Balancing your personal life and life in the political eye can be difficult, and there's a lot to it. But how do you balance your personal life while building the networks and these relationships you need to accomplish these kinds of goals?
You know, you always have to take time for yourself, and you have to find what is your escape. Finding balance is important, because if you don't have a strong balance, then you're just going to get sucked into it. Finding what you do and setting guidelines for yourself and sticking to them. You know, in my case, you know, I have things every day that I do to start my day, whether it's, you know, I will read, you know, make myself read at least 10 pages, or I'm an active writer, so I get up and write a journal, my thoughts, and it helps you process what you're going to do each day. I'm keen on lists. I think making a plan, whether it's a list or setting your course for the day, is important. And it also gives you a sense of accomplishment at the end of the day, when you can know that, okay, here's my list, I've checked everything off. You know, it's a small thing, but it actually, every accomplishment is a good accomplishment.
Yeah. Yeah,
love it. So and with your role, you know, specifically, there's so much that you do that can end up in the public sphere. People can see what you're doing. So how do you balance that criticism, right? How do you balance that fact that, like, hey, this is what I know we need to do, even if maybe some pundit somewhere doesn't really understand what we're trying to get done? How do you keep yourself motivated to keep moving in the direction when all that comes?
It's kind of funny. When I first started doing the commenting and the contributing on the air, you know, you start getting hit up on Twitter.
Right.
And you know, the first couple of days I was like, you take it personal. And then I finally get to a point, you know, the folks that do my booking, they're like, don't read your tweets. They're like, just don't read them. Don't respond to them. I think my parents take the criticism more than I do.
Yeah.
You know, if they see something that somebody has said, they get really upset about it. And I said, don't respond. Please don't feed into it. So I think they take it harder than I do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you realize, wow, it's just part of the landscape. It's just the way it is. And you just,
you know, but,
yeah. So
I've accepted the ideal that whether it's good or bad, if they're talking about me, well, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, for sure.
I want to focus a little bit on your military service. After 9/11, you left the political arena and enlisted in the U.S. Navy. And over the years, you were called up for multiple deployments and at one point operated throughout Iraq as an intelligence officer and senior interrogator. Tell us about that specific experience and how that actually changed your life.
You know, I tell a lot of people that I wouldn't be sitting here today in the position that I'm in had it not been for 9/11. The chart or the course that I had planned for my life is completely different than what I thought. Going to Iraq and also, you know, going through the training process to become an intelligence officer was pretty intense. And, you know, it tested your moral fiber. I always tell everybody, you know, a few times I thought my moral compass was broke because growing up in a conservative Christian household, you know, we take the teachings very close. But to do intel, especially in a human side, you have to challenge that. And so I think it did change me. But I also had the benefit to work side by side, especially in the special forces community, the SEAL community, of some of the most talented and gifted warfighters that have ever been created on this earth, and they are the tip of the spear and truly phenomenal. Many of them are my dear friends to this day, and I know that we did a lot of good. And yeah. You know, one of the reasons that, you know, we've not seen large scale terror attacks in this country is because of the good that we were doing and the good that everyone who serves in uniform or serves this country, even out of uniform, it takes everyone to do this. And everyone that puts on that uniform or raises their right hand to this country, even when you question some of the decisions of our politicians, should be proud of the job that they do.
Right.
And so, you know, I left the Navy after 18 years of both active and reserves and thought I was done. But, you know, this past August, took on a whim, you know, have now rejoined the Kentucky National Guard as an intelligence officer again.
Wow. That's great. You know, today, I mean, that 9/11, significant event in our history, and then today, the day that we're making this taping, the 80th anniversary of Pearl Harbor, you look at these significant moments in our history. What are those moments, what do they teach us about what we need to do and be prepared as we move forward in a conflicted world? It should speak volumes to us. And what are some of those important lessons?
You know, the biggest thing I tell everybody, you know, people want to talk about 9/11 and they want to talk about December 7th. I always tell everyone, you know, let's focus on December 8th. Let's focus on the 12th of September. Mm. Because to me, those are the 2 days that showed what the fiber of this country is about.
Yeah.
You know, for those, you know, I wish we could go back to the day after 9/11. You know, yes, there was a lot of grief. There was a lot of horror. But we put all of our politics aside and actually took time to embrace our neighbor, to be proud of the country that we live in. And, you know, sometimes I wish people would just remember that. Yeah. and forget about all this infighting, trying to focus on, you know, how to have the best tweet or the best soundbite. And remember that when we come together as Americans, we're damn strong, and we need to be that way again. Because, you know, as our motto says, together we stand, divided we fall. And when we're divided in a nature that we are sometimes, all that does is create an opportunity for our adversaries.
Yeah.
And I wish people would realize that.
Yeah. And when you think about it, you know, when you're in uniform, no one cares what political party you're affiliated to. No one cares about your background. No one cares about your, you know, whatever, all the different things that we've used to divide us over the years. Can you talk a little bit about why, you know, the service, military service, and the mindset that comes from that is so important for our country, and why it's something that, you know, maybe even if you've never served before, something we should appreciate as Americans?
You know, the one thing about being in uniform is we all bleed the same color. Mm. And it doesn't matter your religion, your color, your gender, your orientation, whether you're rich or poor or whatever. But when you're in the fight and you know that person to your left and that person to your right has your back, That's what makes you strong, because you realize that you're in this together, and there is something that you're fighting for, something you're serving that is bigger than yourself. One of the things that most people don't notice or take for granted is when you see a service member in uniform, you know, they'll have their name tape with their last name, and it'll be on their right, on their right side. But the branch, whether it's U.S. Navy, U.S. Army, whatever, is always on the left side, because that's because the closest thing to your heart is the service that you represent, not yourself, not your individuality, but the service that is this United States. That's what's closest to your heart.
Wow. It's so powerful. And, you know, today you serve as an advisory council member for the U.S. Veterans Initiative for Homeless Veterans, and on the advisory council as a member of the Veterans Campaign. And you can continue to serve our nation in various ways. You're publishing a lot of articles. You write a lot about specifically the problem of homelessness among veterans. And with these committees, you're doing a lot of work to help kind of address the needs. Can you talk a little bit about the needs of this community specifically in America, and how can we be supportive of helping our homeless veterans?
You know, this is a crucial time for a lot of veterans, especially with COVID and the pandemic, because people have never been more isolated in our lifetime. And with isolation comes a lot of spiral effect of people going downhill fast, because you've taken away their network, or I call it your tribe. People who have come home and they're either detached from their families or they have mental health issues, they rely on those programs to survive. And when you take that away and you make people lock themselves up to stay away, that's when people deteriorate really fast. Veterans are one group of people who think they can fix themselves. They think they can go home, they can lock the doors, shut the windows, and heal themselves. And oftentimes, more often than not, that turns into a downward spiral. A lot of the veteran programs that are out there today, you know, because they can't socialize, they can't hold their events, their funding is really drawn up, and they need it now more than ever, because those programs are crucial. Whether it's, you know, a softball game or a network event, or even just building community, it's so important, because a lot of times, you know, those small groups and those small acts of kindness save a life. And just this past weekend, you know, I had a dear friend we nearly lost and nearly became one of those statistics, because the holidays and all the things that go along with the holidays had started to set in. And the holidays are really hard for a lot of the veteran community because they start reflecting too much, and then they start to question their own self-worth. So, you know, I tell everybody the biggest thing you can do each day, it's not just a veteran, but to anyone, is just be kind. People need it now more than ever.
Yeah, great, great wisdom. And we're so grateful for our conversation. We want to be respectful of your time. So we're going to move into our fire round and just ask you a few questions surrounding kind of everything we've discussed. And again, just kind of answer with your gut. We want to grab some few practical and applicable pieces of advice from you for our listeners. Yeah. So I think we got about three questions. So Michael, if you want to start.
Yeah, start us off. So what would be the first piece of advice you would give to someone who wants to start a campaign or enter that world of politics?
The first thing I would say when you want to start a campaign is to go through your phone list in your phone, because that's going to be your first donor base. Everyone that you're going to ask for money, they're all in your directory right now. Yeah. And don't be afraid to ask, because campaigns are expensive. And if you're shy about that, then, and you're shy about asking your friends, then you won't be able to ask your friends or family. But also be sincere. You know, one of the things that I still do to this day that I learned early on in my days with Senator McConnell is take the time to write a personal note. You know, emails are meaningless. I go through a ton of stationery, and I believe that a handwritten note is the best gesture that you can still do to this day. So much that in the last week, even as much as our firm has grown, I hand signed 500 Christmas cards, not with a signature, but a note and a signature that went out to everyone.
Wow, that's great. How can young leaders be disciplined in their careers?
You know, the biggest thing I think young leaders need today is find a mentor.
That's good.
And and stick to it. You know, my mentor, that was my mentor 30 years ago, is still my mentor to this day. Mm-hmm. We still talk once or twice a week, because I can't learn everything. Yeah. And he always told me, you know, to pay it forward. And I have the pleasure and the honor of, you know, not only the intern program we have at Bramer Group, where we bring in 2 to 3 interns a semester, but I have several young men and women that I mentor on a constant basis, and I'm extremely proud of them. And I'm proud of what they've become, because I've seen several of the folks that I've mentored who are now doing amazing things. And they're, you know, they're vice presidents of companies, or they're writers, or they're lawyers. And just to know that I had a small part of that is incredible. I always tell people, decide what you want to be in life, find the people that are doing that, and become their friends.
Yeah.
And that's how you'll build a great mentor.
Love it. Love it. Last question to close this out today. What advice would you give to maybe servicemen and women who are preparing to come off the field for the first time, make that transition back into civilian life? What would you advise them to be thinking about doing?
I think the same thing that I just said. Find that mentor. You know, when you join the military, they give you what they call sponsor. Mm. And that's the person that helps indoctrinate you from civilian life to the military. When you move to a new base, they give you a sponsor. That's the person that helps show you around a new command and make sure you find everything. It's no different. You know, we cannot do this alone. And I think the hardest thing that people want to accept is they, especially, you know, a lot of the men, it's, you know, there's something wrong with asking for help. There's absolutely not. You know, having a good sponsor or a good mentor when you come off, it is good. I get a lot of people who are transitioning who will find me on LinkedIn and, you know, ask, like, you want to have a coffee. Mm. And there's absolutely, that's what you should do. You know, if you're wanting to get out of the military and you're wanting to go into a specific area, you know, find those people, find them on LinkedIn. Everyone, if you look nowadays, we're all connected, you know, 2 to 3 links away. And if you don't know someone, but you see an ally or a friend of yours is, ask them, like, hey, will you do an introduction? There's nothing wrong with that. The resources now are so incredible that it's easy to find people to connect with you. And I can't think of anybody that would ever say no if you ask them, if you like, have a cup of coffee and just pick their brain.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, I want to thank you, Don, for, first of all, for your service to our nation. We are grateful and we honor you for that, and grateful that you continue to serve our nation in a variety of ways to make it stronger and a better place. Just want to thank you again for joining us today on Framework Leadership Podcast. Always grateful for insight and encouragement and wisdom and advice, and you've given us plenty of that today, so thank you.
Thank you for having me. I've enjoyed spending time with both of you gentlemen today.
Love it. And if you want to stay up to date with Don, you can follow him on Instagram and Twitter at Donald R. Bramer. Did I get that right? Donald R. Bramer?
Yes, you got perfect. It right.
Awesome. And if you are watching us on YouTube right now, you like this content, you want more leadership to help grow you, get your leadership to the next level, go ahead and hit that like button, hit that subscribe button. You can also check us out on Instagram at Kent_Engel or Twitter at Kent Engel. And if you want more leadership content right to your inbox every single week, visit our website, kentengel.com. Subscribed to the newsletter so you can get it every single Friday morning. If you wanted to know when it comes out, it's right there for you. Thank you so much for listening to Framework Leadership.
Take care, everybody.